Okay, thank you very much for the invitation to give a talk. So I will talk about PEPs, which already appeared in Yasu's talk. In a bit more detail, what I want to do is to understand MPO symmetries. They also appeared to some extent in Yasu's talk for the case of PEPs describing ground states of string net models through topological field theory. And there are various motivations for doing that. If you have a PEPs describing string nets, then there are situations where you want to allow for boundaries. And this has various applications, for example, for some aspects of error correcting codes. And another important area is the relation to conformal field theory. There has been introduced something called a strange correlator, which allows you to understand various aspects of conformal field theories directly on the lattice. And there are many more, but I don't want to talk about these motivations in any detail. What I will do is start with a short reminder about PEPs and MPO, partly repeating what Yasu has already explained. Then I will tell you how to get from MPO symmetries to fusion categories and bimodule categories. And then in particular, in a particular case, the situation where the bimodule category is invertible, describe a certain tumor Ritter context in fusion categories. And this will be the first half of the talk. And in the second half, I will try to explain how these results can be understood in terms of state sum topological field theories. And all of this is work in progress together with these four people here. So matrix product states first, they do not appear in the title, but I want to start with them in order to get an explanation of why we talk about PEPs. The MPS case is the one-dimensional case. If you have a gapped Hamiltonian for one-dimensional lattice with periodic boundary conditions and translational invariants, then we can define certain states which are an efficient approximation for the ground states of those systems as an element of the state space, which is a tensor product of state spaces for each site. And this is given by such a formula here, where the input is a certain rank 3 tensor, where two legs have dimension d, that's called the virtual dimension, and a third leg has dimension small d, that's the dimension of this physical space that we have at each side. And the AJ that appear here in this formula are just the capital D by capital D matrices, which I get when I when J has a fixed value. And diagrammatically, a picture that certainly many of you have already seen, this is expressed by such a picture here. Let me mention the so-called fundamental theorem of MPS. It will not be directly important, but something similar will play a certain role. We call an MPS injective if the matrices AJ for all values of J upon linear combination and forming products give you the full D squared dimensional matrix algebra. And then the fundamental theory of MPS states that you have two such injective MPS based on an MPS tensor A and an MPS tensor B, then the two states that I get are equal if and only if the matrices A and B are related by conjugation by a matrix X up to possibly a phase. Now, let me also mention a different description of these MPS. Namely, we can take at each side two D-dimensional degrees of freedom that's indicated here. Then we maximally entangle pairs on neighboring sites, which I indicate by this picture. And then map these degrees of freedom that I have here to the physical space that corresponds to my matrix A. And this is indicated by this picture. The only reason I'm showing this is to show you that an MPS matrix product state can be realized in this way. And that is what one would call a projected entangled pair state, because we have entangled pairs here and then deal with those. Now, projected entangled pair states is abbreviated by PEPS, and PEPS is usually used in two dimensions. But what I have just shown to you shows that you can already do this in one dimension. The virtue of this construction is that it generalizes directly to any dimension. And I will do this in two dimensions. That, that's a value for which the term PEPS usually is reserved. So a picture in two dimensions would be as follows. At each side in the two dimensional lattice, I have a corresponding picture where I have these entanglements at these sides. And then these lines here correspond to the physical leg of the tensors here. And when I do that, then here I get a PEPS tensor, which has one physical leg and a certain number n of virtual legs. In the picture, it's four. That's actually the same type of picture that appeared in Yasser's talk. And I will abbreviate this by pictures like this here. But what I will, when I will do concrete calculations, I will instead not work with a square lattice, but with a hexagonal lattice, so that this number n of virtual legs is equal to three. Then we need matrix product operators. And these have been introduced in the connection of with the observation that to describe the properties of PEPS wave functions that describe ground state of string net models, then you have to deal with certain symmetries of this PEPS tensor A, and those symmetries you can realize through what is called the matrix product operator, which I denote by B hat here. And this is obtained as follows. I will not go into detail. Here are some references, which partly also were mentioned by Yasu in his talk. The operator is associated to some kind of defect line in my lattice. It is local in the sense that it consists of various tensors, which I call B here, which now have four legs, two internal legs, which are drawn in red, and two external legs. And then my operator B hat is defined here in a similar way as a trace as we have defined MPS, where now the external legs are contracted with the virtual legs of the PEPS tensors. So that means in the summations here, we have a capital D. Now, the reason that these objects are called MPOs is actually kind of historical, because a different possibility is not to take the external dimension to be the virtual dimension of the PEPS, but rather the physical dimension of an MPO, and then of an MPS, and then you can use the MPO as an operator acting on the MPS. Well, that is the setting that I'm considering. And now let's see how this is related to various types of categories. And I start with a tentative description of MPOs in connection to fusion categories. I will use the following abbreviated notation. So this small disk here would be my MPO tensor B, and I just indicate the two types of legs now by in this way. And also I'm looking at a whole family of MPO tensors labeled by some index A. the same label, the same labeling actually that, that Yasu has been using. And now you can observe that if you have two of the corresponding operators, then by just concatenating the external legs of the corresponding tensors at each site, you can fuse any two of these MPOs. Now, by invoking an analog of the fundamental theorem of MPS, that's called the fundamental theorem of MPO, you can argue that actually the fusion of such two operators can be written as a linear combination. And that means there's a corresponding fusion tensor, which I indicate by this picture here. Now, one possible interpretation is
for in Yatsu's talk, he has like four external lag and one internal lag. Is it like
We will maybe I should not go into that now. Maybe we can see it later. Let me continue here. So there is one possibility to say, well, this is just describes a tensor product in a fusion category, where the label A corresponds to isomorphism classes of simple objects, and then the associativity of the fusion would be encoded into the 6J symbols of the category C, which I denote by a zero F here. The reason for this additional label will become clear soon. And we would just say that the two possible ways of fusing that I describe here and here are described by the, are related by the 6J symbol. But there is a more general interpretation. Let me just say, well, this is just a tensor with certain labels, which I don't want to identify in detail, and they correspond to, well, they have to satisfy a recoupling identity in which the 6J symbol of this fusion category C appears. Now, what I precisely mean by MPO representation here will have to be explained, and I will not explain it right away, but rather have a look at the PEPs first. For that, I look at the concrete PEPs description of ground states of string net models that has been considered in the literature, except that I allow for arbitrary fusion categories or arbitrary fusion multiplicities in particular. So the formulas will look a little bit more, will have more labels on them. So doing that, if you look what that means, is that the PEPS tensor that I have described so far, this has three virtual legs and the physical leg, which is not shown here, that really corresponds to this situation here. This is often called the triple line notation. It just says that I have additional labels and at the ends here, I have a multiplicity which is the possible values for this are fixed by this triple of labels that I have here. And at this point, this is just a description which you can use in various ways. And then, of course, you should ask what have all these labels, how can I explain their presence? And one possibility, again, is to say that I have a fusion category. I call it now D. It's a different one from the one I have talking about before, so the different name here, where all these labels that I have here are just, again, labels for simple objects, and then the multiplicities are just correspond to basis choices in corresponding morphism spaces. So if I have A alpha C here at this vertex, then this corresponds to the tensor product to the space of morphisms from A tensor alpha to C, and analogously for the other ones. And then the middle label K, which corresponds to the physical leg, which is sticking out of the screen, that would again be of the same type. But again, this is only one possible interpretation. A more general interpretation, in this case, the PEPS tensor would be nothing but the ordinary 6J symbol of this category D. But again, there is a different interpretation. Namely, you can say that you have this fusion category, but only the labels alpha, beta, gamma correspond to simple objects of the fusion category. And then there is something else. Let me for the moment just call it the PEPS realization, such that I have this identity with the 6J symbol of the fusion category D appearing as a recoupling identity for the PEPS tensor, in the same way as I had an identity, a recoupling identity for the MPO fusion tensor before. Now, what does what is a sensible mathematical interpretation of that? Well, it's that actually I'm describing a situation where I have a module category. So the labels alpha, beta, gamma here will be correspond to simple objects of a fusion category. And the other labels, capital A, B, C, will correspond, will describe simple objects of a right D module category M over a fusion category. So the module category over monoidal category is just the higher analog of a module over a ring. So just like in a ring, you can act with an element on multiply an element to of the ring to an element of the module. Now you can act with an element of your fusion category on an with an object of your fusion category to an object of your module category. And I have described this action here by a little triangle, and it's an action from the right. Just that choice we decide to make here, and there are actually various orientation choices which are implicit, which I do not show here. Now, in this description, the recoupling identity for the PEPS tensor just tells you that the PEPS tensor is what is called a module 6J symbol. And that's the following. It just like the 6J symbol expresses the isomorphism between two tensor products with double tensor products with different bracketing. Now the 6J symbol, which I call module 6J symbols, expresses an isomorphism where we act on an object of the module category first with alpha and then with beta. And compare this to the action of the tensor product of alpha with beta. Or in pictures, this would be the description of this 6J symbol. And just for having things completely explicit, I have written here the corresponding this pentagon identity that is given by this recoupling identity before. And of course, you should not look at all the details here. It's just maybe you should remember you have 3, 3 on the left and 3, 3, 4 on the right. So that's why the F symbol for F, which is the ordinary 6J symbol of the fusion category D, appears in that recoupling identity. And this is nothing but the mixed pentagon identity that states the equality of two distinguished isomorphisms between this object here and this object here in the same way as the ordinary pentagon identity states the equality of two distinguished isomorphisms between two triple tensor products in a fusion category. So this gives us an interpretation of PEPS. tenses. Now let's go back to the MPO tenses. Recall we had this recoupling identity for the MPO fusion tensor. In this situation where we describe StringNet models, the fusion tensor again looks more explicitly like here, where I have this triple I notation, simply meaning that these various multiplicity labels that we have here are determined by the triple of these labels. The interpretation now of the recoupling identity. The recoupling identity was very similar to the one that we have for the PEPS tensor. So again, it tells us that we deal with a module category, but we want to have the same underlying category. And now there should be an action also on the fusion category C, and this will be from the left. And then the MPO fusion tensor is precisely of the same type as the PEPS tensor, except that now we deal with the left action of the category fusion category C. So the picture is like that, and corresponding module 6J symbol, which I now call 1F, describes the isomorphism of acting with the tensor product from the left or acting twice from the left. And again, if you write out the recoupling identity, you see that it's just a mixed pentagon identity stating an equality of the two distinguished isomorphisms that you get via the 1F and 0F symbols between the object that we have here and the object that we have here. Well, the next step is to realize that we are still lacking the MPO tensor. And the MPO tensor now, Chen Zhang, maybe that's where what your question referred to. Here we have these four legs. And in the StringNet situation, explicitly, these legs actually correspond to such triple labels, and the full expression is given here. And what we have not yet used is that the MPO tensor satisfies further consistency conditions. First of all, the super condition that's already has been mentioned by in Yasu's talk. So remember the fusion tensor tells you how to fuse different MPOs, but we do that by doing it locally on the lattice. But where precisely we do that that on the lattice should not matter, and therefore we have an identity which in the simplified notation looks like this. And there is another condition called the pulling through condition, which comes from the fact that the MPOs, these are, I have called them to correspond to defect lines, and those lines I can move freely through the lattice of PEPT tensors. That's what one requires, and this is actually related to a renormalization group transformation for MPOs that are required to be scale invariant. So we have these two additional conditions. And again, this has an interpretation in terms of categories, namely M is not only a right module category over the fusion category D, and simultaneously a left module category over the fusion category C, but these two actions are compatible. So M is a bimodule category. And then correspondingly, there will be a bimodule 6J symbol, expressing that we have an isomorphism between the situation where we first act from the right and then from the left, or the other way around. Or in pictures, we have such a relation. This is again analog of the defining picture for ordinary 6J symbols, except that instead of tensor products, now we have a left and a right action to consider here. And we call I call this bimodule 6J symbol 2F. And then the zipper and pulling through conditions look like this. And again, they are just mixed pentagon identities. So let me summarize this. If we have a situation with a PEPS tensor, MPO tensor, and MPO fusion tensor, and all these consistency relations I have been listing, then the these data and conditions amount to having a pair of fusion category C and D and a bimodule category M, which is a left C and right D module category. And I have identifications that the PEPS tensor gives me the module constraint for the right action, the MPO fusion tensor gives me the module constraint for the left action, and the MPO tensor is the bimodule constraint. And also I have corresponding identifications of the various pentagon and mixed pentagon identities. And to summarize this in one sentence, if I have a string net PEPS, which satisfies a recoupling condition described by a fusion category D, and MPO symmetries described by a fusion category C, then this is possible if and only if there is a CD bimodule category such that the constraints for this system are those that I have been describing. We can look at a special case that M is an invertible bimodule category, and then what we get is a two Morita context or also a two object bi category. So we have a bi category with two objects, which I denote here by a black dot and a white dot. And then the one morphisms of one of them are the fusion category C, the one morphisms of the other one. Endomorphisms are the give the fusion category D, and the one morphism categories from one to the other are M and the opposite category M bar. And in this particular situation, D is nothing but what is called the dual of C with respect to M. So this is the category of module endofunctors of M, and also the other way around. And in particular, this implies that the Drinfeld centers of C and of D are equivalent. But I will not go into that, but rather now in the last part of the talk, try to describe how you can get these results from a picture in which we apply a certain topological field theory of a state sum type to a suitable manifold. So the data that we have are now, besides our PEPS tensor A and MPO tensor P, some surface sigma for which we choose a cell decomposition. And for concreteness, I take this decomposition such that it's a honeycomb lattice, so it, thereby it fits directly to what I have been saying. And then according to what we have seen for the PEPS tensor in this situation, the space that is associated to the physical leg of the tensor A is given by the by morphism space, morphism spaces of this fusion category D. And that I have at each side of my lattice. So to the surface as a whole, I will associate just the tensor product over all vertices of the lattice of these spaces for each side. And of course, this depends on my cell decomposition. But there is a protective space or physical subspace, which I get by looking only at those states where I have contracted all the virtual legs of the PEPS tensors. And you can convince yourself that this does not depend on the cell decomposition. And the goal is now to obtain this protective subspace, more explain it in terms of a Torrey-Feurtheit state sum construction. And this construction should be such that these PEPS and MPO bimodule categories, and in the special case, the bicategory that I have described can be inferred from that construction. I should mention that in the, this is completely analogous to what in one dimension, so for MPS, has been done already a few years ago. And also there is a description of what is happening in the case that M equals to D, so just D as a bimodule over itself, meaning that also C is equal to D. If you look at the paper, you will see that you can describe their results as a specialization of what I'm going to describe now. So the strategy is the following. We take a Torrey-Feurt topological field theory. So the input will be some, it should be spherical fusion category D. The topological field theory is a functor which assigns to a three manifold linear map from the in boundary to the out boundary. And we look at a particular type of three manifold where the in boundary is empty. So the corresponding state space are just the complex numbers. Then the output, the out boundary is the surface sigma that on which I have defined my PEPS tensor network. So in this situation, applying the Torrey-Feurt functor to my manifold will give me a linear map from the complex number to the state space of sigma. And that means if I apply that map, say, to the number one in C, I will get some distinguished vector in the state space. And what I want to show it then is that the vector that I get is, in fact, the PEPS state that is obtained for the PEPS tensor A, which, remember, corresponds to the module constraint of this bimodule M. And once I know that this is the case, then explicit construction of the Torrey-Feurt functor here will in particular provide the construction of the protected subspace. And in order to make this going, I have to tell you first what the three manifold M sigma is. I take just the cylinder over sigma. So this has two copies of sigma as a geometric boundary, but I take only one copy of them, say sigma tensor with one, as what you usually take, what the boundaries here are about. That's also called the gluing boundary. That's where the microscopic degrees of freedom of my model are located. Whereas the other boundary at t equal to zero, I take to be a physical boundary where I specify boundary conditions. And that means that a manifold is of such a type. And then let's see what we can do in order to arrive at the situation that I want to have. So we first fix a skeleton for this three manifold, which does not have vertices or edges on the gluing boundary. For simplicity, just take this to be consist of prisms, which just are cylinders over the honeycomb lattice that I have on the physical boundary. And then I attach state sum variables to the plaquettes that I have in the interior. They are drawn in blue here, and they correspond to simple objects of D, whereas the plaquettes in the boundary, which is drawn in green, are labeled by simple objects of the module category. So if I look in a bit more detail, that would mean labels A, B, C on these green hexagons and alpha, beta, gamma on these faces here. Then to every edge in my skeleton, I associate a vector space. Edge consists of two half edges. And I define a vector space for a half edge just to be a morphism space that is defined by the labels of the three plaquettes which it touches. So if I'm in the interior, all blue here, then I will have a morphism spaces in D. Whereas if I'm on the boundary, then I will have a morphism space in M. So for example, at this edge E1 here, I will have labels A and B from the green plaquettes and label gamma from the blue plaquette here, and I will deal with this space here and analog and then I take the tensor product of this space with its dual. And then if I look at the whole three manifold now with chosen skeleton, to that I associate the vector space, which I just get by taking the tensor products over all edges of these spaces that I have assigned to each individual edges. Now in these vector spaces, there are canonical vectors because they often form a vector space tensored with its dual. So I take an arbitrary basis in VE and take the dual basis in VE star, and then I take this particular vector here. And if I do this for all the edges in my skeleton, Then I get a canonical vector in this vector space VP that is associated to my three manifold with chosen skeleton. And then the next step is to define a suitable evaluation map. And for this one uses the description of Turayev-Viro state sum theories as given in the book by Turayev and Virilisier. And that works as follows. I look at an arbitrary vertex in P, draw a closed ball around it, like here, and then the intersection of the ball with the plaquettes will give rise to some lines on this on the surface sphere of this ball. Together with vertices where they meet, and naturally each of the lines inherits an object label from the corresponding plaquette, and each of the vertices inherits a vector space label from the relevant half edge. And then what I have obtained is a labeled graph on this sphere. And Turayev and Virilisier tell you how to evaluate such a graph. Essentially, this is again with the choice that I have made to use this particular P will be just. Evaluation of a tetrahedral graph, and evaluation of a tetrahedral graph will give you some type of 6J symbol. And indeed, by expection, you see that the tetrahedral graph you get for this particular vertex is nothing but the PEPS tensor that we have seen before. And that means that the prescription for evaluation at this vertex is simply to associate to this the corresponding 3F symbol, up to some convenient normalizations, actually. Now, if you now look what you're actually doing, then you see that you deal with a map from the tensor product over the vector spaces for all half edges incident to a given, to the vertex we are talking about, to the complex numbers. And if you then look at the vertex, at the vector space for your whole three manifold, you can define an evaluation by the tensor product of all these evaluations. And what you get thereby is a map from the vector space to the tensor product of the vector spaces associated to the edges that are ending on the gluing boundary. That's because there are no vertices on the gluing boundary. So there is one half edge left for all those edges. And well, by construction, this is just the space H sigma. And now we have an evaluation map and we have defined a canonical vector. So the last step will be to evaluate this, to apply this evaluation map to the canonical vector. And what you see is just that in that you get precisely the PEPS description of the ground state that is associated to the fusion category D and module category M. And also by construction, of course, this is a vector in the state space of the topological field theory. So in particular, it lies in the protected space as it should. Let me briefly mention that you can also extend this to the situation where on your physical boundary, you have additional Wilson lines. That means that you do not have just one module category, but you have different regions on your physical boundary labeled by, say, module categories M1 and M2. And then, so here, this would be a region with M1. Here, you have a region with M2. And you can show that the defect lines between two such regions correspond to objects in the category of D module functors from M1 to M2. And again, you can define then an evaluation map by the same prescription as before, except that now one of your lines is labeled by this new type of object. So you get a new type of graph, and it is not guaranteed that this is a graph that has already appeared in what I have been doing before. And indeed, there are two situations where you can directly use the results from before. Just take the situation that M1 is equal to M2, then the defect lines between M and M are just this functor category D, but this is a dual category, so it's C. And not surprisingly, what you find then is that the evaluation of the graph obtained in this situation gives you the MPO tensor, which is the which is a 2F symbol. And another special case is that one of the two module categories is actually the tensor category D as a module over itself. Then the functor category can be naturally identified with the module category. In this case, you get a 3F symbol. That's the end of my talk. Let me just tell you what one should also try. Of course, in the last situation, we should try to describe also what happens for arbitrary pairs of module categories M1 and M2. It turns out that when you want to do that, a useful tool is what is called module Eilenberg-Watts calculus, and you will hear a little bit about that probably in the next talk. Then, of course, one should describe the excitations. We have seen, well, these are the, what people call anions. So these lie in the Drinfeld center of D, and then you should go back to the motivation and see whether with what I have told you actually you can do that stuff that motivated you to look at these structures. Thank you.